and welcome to the hard sell where the stick in the swill bucket rattles back. It's World Cup time again. Rugby World Cup, I mean. And if you're wondering who cares about that, other than people called Tristram and Torquil, shut up and fuck off. The game will probably always be associated with the Eton set and above, but where I come from, Cornwall, it's the working man's game. Honest. Even more so in the other Celtic outposts of Scotland, Ireland, and especially Wales, where it's practically a state religion, at least when the national team is playing. It's just the English that ruin everything. Yet again. Now, this is actually the third Rugby World Cup in this programme's lifetime, because I've been doing it so long, I don't even know what subjects I've done anymore. I really need an index. But I do know I haven't done rugby, because I tried in 2015 and couldn't find anything. Well, sod it, today's the day. Even if I have to search the most obscure parts of the internet, even if every video is in real player Lego vision or covered with watermarks, we're doing rugby. God help us all. Incidentally, to clarify, when I talk about rugby, I'm generally talking about rugby union, my preferred code, the other being rugby league. There is, as you can imagine, a certain amount of animosity there, but let the record show that anyone claiming one code is better than the other is a massive bell end. They're just different, get over it. That said, I vastly prefer union, because it includes scrums, rucks and mauls, the bits where several ugly blokes bash their heads against several other ugly blokes and push each other around. League skips those, it's faster. I also find it duller. I've watched league games and always feel vaguely frustrated. It's like they're about to start playing actual rugby and then stop short. But to league fans, of course, union is grindingly slow and dull. All pushing and shoving and attrition and gradual territorial dominance. To me and other union fans, that's the point. We don't find it dull, we find it suspenseful. What we find dull is the code that skips over all the suspense and just runs back and forth for 80 minutes like basketball, which conversely they see as exciting and athletic. I'm not going to argue with them, but I don't see it that way. It's fine, there's room for both. Although if they do make objectively wrong statements like union being for pussies, which I have heard in the past, then I will argue back by reminding them of which code includes 16 huge, ugly, sweaty blokes forming a turtle and grabbing each other by the balls. Anyway, that's not really relevant, it's just a rant. Adverts are all about immediate imagery, so either code of rugby is really all the same to them, and they tend to use them interchangeably. Although union has the edge, because again, it has scrums and league doesn't. The scrum is just a visually arresting and familiar image. Sorry, league fans, the union is just the iconic version of the sport. Deal with it. So, adverts. There still actually aren't that many. It's not as popular a sport as football. It generally occupies second or third place, swapping with cricket, depending on the time of year and the relative success of the national teams. But it does have all that iconic imagery. Even football doesn't have quite such a powerful and immediate depiction of conflict. So its advertorial use is far from unknown. It's rare enough that there's no great narrative to weave, however. So instead, let's just look at some adverts and point and laugh. And if we learn something, we'll call it a bonus, okay? Okay. Crouch. Touch. Pause. Engage.
Pick a door. When men get together, let's pick a door there. 'Cause pick a door's great anytime, anywhere. Pick a door.
This, from 1964 on, is a classic example of several things at once. First, the way in which adverts spoke to men in the mid-60s, which is to say, reeking of musk and testosterone, and filtering the message through sport or technology, specifically manly technology, involving either making or breaking stuff. Rugby was a particularly good choice, because its heavy contact, sweaty, muddy, ugly nature is a ripe field for the harvesting of traditionally masculine imagery. Note the key line in the jingle.
When men get together, there's thicker door there.
When men get together to be men together, watching men fighting other men over an egg. How Freudian is that in itself, by the way? While smoking great big manly cigars. Women's rugby isn't even conceivable in this world. Just a few yards worth of corduroy is keeping this whole scenario from going full Tom of Finland. Of course, there's a certain dissonance in rugby, or any sport really, being used to advertise tobacco products, which actively hinder or even prevent you from taking part in them. But we didn't care about that in 1965, hence advertising them on television. Also, shout out to the modernist atonal music. Or the intro, anyway. Of course, male grooming products have often, particularly at that time, had to walk a fine line between manliness and the inherent girliness of vanity. Not, I hasten to add, that vanity is actually inherently feminine in any way, it's just been forcibly associated with women over the centuries, to the point that by 1964 it represents something of a starting handicap for male grooming products. As for example...
Bill Travers is hard. Plays his rugby hard. But Bill, like most men, wants his hair to be soft. That's why he uses Brill Cream.
Bill Travers was indeed a hard man, assuming that really is the actor Bill Travers, his cavernous chin dimple appears to have gone missing. But he was famous enough in 1970 for this to be a weird choice of name for a fictional character. There was a rugby player called William Travers, better known as Bunner, but I was in the 30s. Not likely to be him. If it is the actor, his credentials are definitely unimpeachable. He once walked hundreds of miles through the Burmese jungle in yellow-faced disguise while fighting off malaria to avoid capture by the Japanese. And that's just one anecdote. A hairy-chested slab of meat like him would have to play rugby as a hobby, especially to offset the brokering.
A little dab replaces the natural moisture your hair loses every day, keeps it soft, keeps it healthy-looking. Bill Travers is a hard man, all right. But he keeps his hair soft with Brill Cream.
By the early 70s, we didn't have to be quite so on the nose about it. Partly by having the players speak for themselves.
I had two problems with my hair. The dandruff and the grease. But not anymore. Because now I use new All Clear shampoo every time.
It really goes in hard on the dandruff. And after a tackle like this, the dandruff's got no chance.
Notice the hard, manly language again. They could have used a football team for this, but they wanted to really hammer home how uncompromisingly tough and indeed violent this shampoo was against dandruff, in a masculine sort of way. Rugby provides a better metaphors. Norman Hunter tackles notwithstanding.
But because one All Clear, especially for greasy, it gives my hair every chance. You know what I mean?
Come on, Charlie.
Hey!
New All Clear for dry, normal and greasy. It clears dandruff and keeps hair in good condition.
Then there's this from 1984. All of a sudden, things have changed.
Mine's a Campari and orange juice.
You visiting teams make a point of being unorthodox.
This time we're actively playing against the manly testosterone-sodden image to try to sell Campari, which is, of course, a bitters, as opposed to bitter, the sort of beer which is quite popular in the clubhouse after a rugby match. Campari is the wrong kind of bitter, the kind with an S on the end that's made with botanicals and fruit and other such effeminate business, which is why our stereotypical rugbyman is looking down on it, while drinking his singular bitter. From a studded tankard, no less. Not only manlier, but more working class.
Well, that's a refreshing change in this game.
I think you're a bit too fly by half. I'm a bitter man myself.
You'll have noticed the rugby player has the regional accent and the Campari head, and I'm going to get to the head, don't worry. The Campari head is cut glass. Personally, I find this quite refreshing in a way, no pun intended. An acknowledgement that rugby can be and often is as working class a game as football. Of course, an altered accent would actually suggest rugby league, which presents itself as exactly that, the working class version of rugby. And there are no other trappings around to suggest either code. But I would point out that this advert actually includes a rugby pun.
I think you're a bit too fly by half.
Too fly by half, referencing the rugby position of fly half. The playmaker, the one who usually does the kicking. Sort of the Cristiano Ronaldo equivalent figure in the team. And unique to rugby union. League, which has fewer players, doesn't use the term. Therefore, I posit that this is a union player. A frustrated proletarian union player being outwitted by a kind of Etonian twat who often monopolises the game's image.
So would I be. I were kicked in sensible every Saturday.
Campari. It's the last word.
Of course, the class war stuff is overshadowed somewhat by the bizarre visual choice to give the Ponce a big quantelled Campari glass for a head. Which is distracting, and to modernise, kind of makes it look like a lazy meme. It would have worked perfectly well played straight, with two blokes who have human heads and such. And I get the feeling that at any other time, that's how they would have done it. But they just got this Quantel paint box technology. This was the thing they could do now. So they did it. Doesn't improve anything, but they did it anyway.
I think you're a bit too fly by half. I'm a bitter man myself.
So would I be. I were kicked in sensible every Saturday.
Campari. It's the last word.
Alright, so much for the sociology of the game, gender roles and class and what have you. What about the actual game itself, in practice? Its extreme physicality must be a good source of advertorial protein, whatever that means. Well, sure, take a look at this.
I wonder what it feels like to be a bit of banana crammed into a banana bix.
Drink more coffee. Anyway, you know where this is going.
New banana bits. So crammed with banana, it makes you wonder.
It absolutely does not. Although the advert does a bit, you'd expect it to jump cut back to him at the breakfast table right when the players smash into him on all sides. And he smiles and eats another mouthful and ho ho ho, what a whimsical vision he just had. Instead, he goes for something a bit more surreal and ambiguous by first having him depart for his dream, I guess, and then having him materialise injured in the real world. Fortunately, you're not supposed to think too hard about these things, so I won't.
New banana bits. So crammed with banana, it makes you wonder.
And here's something from Japan. Don't look surprised, if you are looking surprised, which you probably aren't. But anyway, they hosted the last World Cup in 2019 and are getting quite good at the sport. In fact, England are due to play them in a couple of days, if you're watching this on Patreon, or just played them a week ago, if you aren't. And with the greatest of respect, hopefully they won. If they didn't, congratulations on being here to see this part before I re-recorded it for the public version. That's what you signed up to Patreon for. Anyway, the advert. It's a slice of Japanese absurdism, which is always fun.
Comes out of the scrum, and he goes for the centre. Quick start. Oh, he's hit! There's a big pileup. Mie Rice comes out. He's broke free. He's making a move. Oh, he's caught. This looks bad. Passes it out. Dodges one, two. Oh, that was a big hit. Oh, some of the players seem to be getting excited here. Uh-oh, gotta watch it out there. Goes for the side again. Uh-oh, oh, he makes it through. He's looking good, he's moving, looking good. And that's a try!
Still really a lot to say about this one. It's funny and it's rugby accurate. Apart from the kit. World rugby laws do stipulate that these salary men would have to wear regulation sportswear. For a real, uncompromising salaryman playing rugby experience, however, and let's face it, it's bound to be someone's fetish, we have to go back to the mid-80s and the technology sector. Advertisers in this period were constantly having to think up ways to sell business products, or sometimes just abstract business concepts, in ways that were visually interesting in some way. A near impossible job, you might think, but that's why they called them creatives. That and because it makes them seem like they're doing something worthwhile.
Think of this as information. It could be your company's single most important resource.
I'm not sure this metaphor really is a metaphor.
ICL are committed to putting that information right onto the desks of those who need it, so that you can extract from the mass of data the precise information you need when you need it.
I get the scrum symbolising the extraction of data, I suppose, on an abstract level, but it doesn't make any actual damn sense.
And ICL's belief and unique skills in networking mean that information can be passed from person to person, from department to department, so that everyone can do their job.
Okay, I'll give you that. Little facile, but it works.
Better.
And so the try is success in general. At whatever it is we're doing here. Because they don't really make it clear. It's computer-based office automation, but it gets so wrapped up in its mixed metaphors it forgets to actually sell the real product. Or even explain it. No wonder the Japanese ate them alive.
ICL. We should be talking to each other.
And then there's the official sponsors of things. You see adverts declaring Mars Bars and Barclays Bank and Bud Light to be the official confectionery bank and beer of various football teams, leagues and tournaments. But rugby, in either code, isn't really big enough for those to be quite as prevalent. But they do still happen. Sometimes there's a touch of bitterness on that exact subject. For example, Land Rover sponsored the England team around the 2007 World Cup, where England were simultaneously the defending champions and a bit shit, which I think is something only England can manage. Anyway, this is their advert in the run-up to that, featuring legendary fullback Josh Lucy.
Maxis, over it!
Oh, come on, mate, what are you doing?
Lovely, look at a little touch.
Now come back, for me!
Oh, forget it.
Now get out the one! Yes!
Who's looking?
Come on,
Maxis.
Oh, what?
Oh, rip!
Look at the skill. Oh, yes, I'm open! Oh, what?
I was just getting rid of it. Oh, come on. Completely having a laugh.
I'm just going to go and get the ball off the big fella, all right? Off the big old fella over here.
There you go, mate. Just give us the ball, would you?
Won't hurt you. Go on.
Just a touch. Just like that. Bang.
Come on!
Yes, well, not exactly an unearned fate, but I prefer to think of it as being because he's a massive insufferable tosser, rather than because of any animosity against football. I mean, I love both sports. No reason to be hating. I do take some issue with the England's real passion thing, though. Sorry, no. Wales, maybe. Ireland, you could make some kind of a case if you don't mind the high possibility of being smashed in the head with a hurley or having a Gaelic football shoved up your ass. But I'm sorry, England's biggest game is association football, and there's no way around that. That's why I've done, well, 4 episodes now about football. I really need an index. Compared with 1 about rugby, which you haven't even finished watching yet. Football's more popular, I think, largely because it's simpler. You kick a ball into a net, that's it. There are laws governing the ways in which you achieve this end, but fundamentally, that's all there is to it. It can be spontaneously generated almost everywhere. All you need is a ball and some delineation of goal areas. Rugby doesn't have that advantage. There's multiple ways of scoring for a start, and more than one interpretation of those. Union, in particular, has so many rules, only about 3 people in the entire world actually know them all. League is more streamlined, but it still has a lot of arcane lore that can seem baffling from the outside. Plus, rugby in either code is more streamlined than football, to the point where about 50% of the time you're basically just having a fight. And this puts off weedy non-athletic types like me from getting into it even more than football does. And that's quite dangerous enough as it is. And of course, the ball is the wrong shape. And there's one particular problem specific to the advertising industry. The fact that it's played by large, ugly blokes who generally have the glamour of a King Edward potato. Not that there's no sex appeal in the game, far from it, especially if you're into cavemen. But your average Gillette advert requires a specific look, which few rugby players have, and those that do don't often stay that way. There are exceptions. Jason Robinson was a Gillette brand ambassador for years, mainly because he was too damn fast for anyone to be able to mess his face up. Josh Lucy's dog has its opinion, but rugby's never going to be as big as football, as evidenced by the amount of Land Rover adverts he's fronted before or since that World Cup. But that's alright. Who needs to be? Even football doesn't need to be that big. Happiness is egg-shaped.
Sat through a Bob the Fish production. Nice! If you haven't already, you absolutely must check out bobthefish.org.uk. Literally hundreds more videos, not unlike that one, adding up to days worth of entertainment and all absolutely free. But if you're not a cold-hearted skinflint, you can always support us on Patreon. For as little as anything at all, you can make programs like the one you just watched possible in the first place, and become eligible for bonus material such as glimpses of the book I'm writing about the BBC, monthly riffings on random commercial breaks, the complete archives of the angry political satire magazine Two Sons, and even the odd very occasional bonus video essay unavailable anywhere else. If nothing else, you should prevent me from starving and or freezing to death in the foreseeable future, so that'd be nice. No pressure or anything. Well, UK, you make it what it is.